Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Hoss, Josh, and Jack, for inviting me, and thank you for coming out this morning. So I've been at Penn for about 8 years now, and I specialize in lung and head and neck cancer, and it's really my pleasure to talk to you about some work that we've done on liquid biopsies and how we use that for patient care as well as for day-to-day management when patients are on targeted therapies. So we've made slow but steady progress over the years for lung cancer, and this is just a cartoon to show you how far we've come. 30, 40 years ago, all we had at our disposal was surgery and radiation therapy, and slowly we've made improvements in chemotherapy integration into general management as sort of the third leg of treatment with surgery as well as radiation therapy, and then we improved upon chemotherapy agents. They became less toxic, they became much more tolerated. We got comfortable with combining them. And then really in the early 2000s, we saw this era of targeted therapy really come in and make a huge transformation in the way we thought about the disease, treated patients, diagnosed them and followed them. And then we started to follow a little bit of, you know, can we combine these targeted agents with chemotherapy? And then what really accelerated our improvements, especially in lung cancer, at least over the last 5 years, have been our ability to offer really these next generation targeted therapies, these second, third generation oral inhibitors, our ability to select patients that may benefit from that, and also integrating immunotherapy into the treatments. How have we improved upon our basic techniques? At Penn, we have something called as tumor glow, where we are able to precisely really figure out where the tumor resides at the time of surgery. There's advances in radiation therapy with protons. As I said, we have much better drugs now than we did in the 1980s and 1990s. And really now we are at the cusp of what we call as our immune revolution. But that wouldn't have been possible if we didn't have better diagnostic techniques and better ability to select patients that may best benefit from them. So this is our standard of care tumor surveillance. How do we monitor patients right now? We usually get a tissue biopsy at diagnosis. I mean, that's mandatory. There's no oncologist who will give you or prescribe a treatment without a tumor biopsy. And then there's standard imaging, which may involve a CAT scan, a chest X-ray, MRI, et cetera. And then we have clinical blood tests. The goal of my presentation is to really talk about how we can do more of the clinical blood tests, more of what's on the right side of the slide, and less of what's on the left side, which is less of tissue biopsy and perhaps less scans. Maybe we can use one or two tubes of blood to really come down to day-to-day management of patients. So what is a liquid biopsy? This is a cartoon from a recent clinical publication, and it just basically highlights what a liquid biopsy is. Traditionally, we think of blood as serving as a liquid biopsy. However, I do want to point out that liquid biopsy actually may be any liquid from the body. You know, we can talk about cerebrospinal fluid or the fluid that circulates around the brain and the meninges and the spinal cord. We can talk about saliva. It's a definitely a valid biopsiable tool for head and neck cancers, for example. We can talk about pleural fluid. This is the accumulation of fluid outside of the lining of the lung, which can be assessed not only to look for cancer cells, but perhaps can it be looked at for circulating tumor DNA. I'll come to the peripheral blood in greater detail, but there are other fluids like a collection of fluid in the belly. We can definitely use stool and urine as well for urine, for example, for detection of mutations, even in EGFR mutant lung cancer. So liquid biopsy is not limited to the use of blood. But the blood is a very rich resource for a wealth of information, and we are just beginning to tap the wealth of information that is available. So there's red blood cells, there's white blood cells, and there's serum and plasma that's available for us to use, and there's circulating fragments of DNA that are shed from the tumors that, so if there's a tumor, it can shed certain particles, including circulating tumor cells, exosomes, which are these tiny, minute particles shed from the tumor itself. And then the most important resource that we've been able to really harness right now is the cfDNA, or the cell-free DNA, that is shed from the tumor into the bloodstream. And the best analogy that I give to patients is when I was pregnant with my second child, I was given the option to find out, to wait till 20 weeks to find out if I had a girl or a boy, or at 10 or 11 weeks I could find out if the sex of the baby. And I said, you know, how are you able to do that? So for initial diagnosis and therapy selection, as you know, it's important to have gene sequencing information at the initial diagnosis. Dr. Baum will talk to you about next generation sequencing. And we do have the ability now with commercially available assays, be it Foundation One or Guardant, that can use two tubes of blood, which can be drawn at the time of initial diagnosis, and that can assess the cell-free DNA component. Oftentimes, tissue biopsy is not available, meaning that it may have been used to make the initial diagnosis, but the amount of tissue may not have been sufficient to really be able to extract DNA to do the whole sequencing. Or another biopsy may be required, or, you know, the diagnosis may have been made 5 years ago, and now we are sitting here with lack of tissue to really determine therapy. And those are the situations where a blood biopsy or a liquid biopsy may be helpful. So we did a study in our patients at Penn, where everyone at initial diagnosis or at the time of progression underwent a liquid biopsy. And this is a simple pie chart to show you how our patient disposition fell out. So we had about 323 patients, and there were a subgroup of patients here in purple, you'll see, that only underwent a liquid biopsy because either they said, hey doc, I already know about liquid biopsy, why don't we just do this and see what results I find out. I would really like to avoid a tissue biopsy. Or the physician said, listen, I think you have a very high likelihood of us being able to find something on your liquid. Let's just start with that first. And so it was either physician or patient choice. We had some patients, so in blue and green, our intent was to do both tissue biopsy as well as liquid biopsy. However, you will see that tissue biopsy was only possible to be performed in about 40% of our entire cohort. And that was because either the biopsy site was not accessible or biopsy was performed, but the amount of sample that was obtained was just not viable or feasible to be studied. Meaning, for example, sometimes if we get a bone biopsy sample, the way that they process the bone biopsy, because the bone biopsy samples have a lot of calcium in them, the way that they are sort of processed by a process called decalcification can sometimes damage the DNA, and that can make it hard for us to really understand the genetic information from a sample like that. So when I say tissue biopsy completed in 40% of the patients was, even though the intent was there, the results or the meaningful results that we obtained were only able to be interpreted in about 40% of the patients. And then for the 31%, no tissue biopsy was possible. You only got ctDNA. And what we found was that by adding on this extra layer of liquid biopsy at either the time of diagnosis or at the time of progression, we were able to improve our ability to detect these therapeutically targetable mutations. And these are these five mutations for which we have drugs that are available, that we were able to increase the percentage significantly from about 20.5% with tissue alone to about 35.8% with tissue and plasma. This we thought was an important observation. We were already using liquid biopsies clinically for our patients at presentation or at diagnosis, but looking at these results really has validated that we must continue to use this approach, and it may serve as a really important tool to detect mutations and be able to deliver targeted therapy. At the recent AACR, there was also a presentation looking at liquid biopsy-based tests using Guardant to identify patients for these therapeutically targetable drugs. And this is a press release from that study, and they basically, it was called the NILE or the non-invasive liquid assay study. They looked at the G7 profile using the Guardant assay, where they looked at EGFR, MET, RET, ROS1, BRAF, ALK, and ERBB2. And what they found was that using this assay, or the Guardant 360 profile, they were able to get the results faster, 9 days versus 15 days with other gene sequencing testing, including tissue. And then it did increase the detection rate by 48%. So this was a prospectively conducted study, and in essence validates the results from our previous study, where we showed that adding liquid biopsy to tissue can improve detection and really improve our ability to be able to offer a targeted therapy. So I put this in there because, you know, there is a lot of evidence now that liquid biopsies may help improve the delivery of personalized care. The second bucket really is to track therapeutic response, and there is evidence that patients who are on EGFR targeted drugs, for example, first, second, third generation TKIs, that physicians may have the ability, at least on a research basis, to be able to check circulating tumor DNA at, let's say, week 6 of therapy, and really find out if there are still EGFR, if there's still circulating EGFR mutation clone in the bloodstream, or is it completely gone. And there are certainly some approaches that are being incorporated in clinical trials, where for these patients that still have persistent circulating EGFR clone, that perhaps adding on other therapies to their existing TKI may be a useful approach. I don't have a lot of slides here for these two buckets because these are purely experimental at this time. These are in research, but this is something which is of a lot of interest to us because, like I said, this is a tool that we can use very easily in a non-invasive fashion in the clinic. And then the third bucket is really monitoring of resistance and tumor heterogeneity. I think the most compelling example of this is the monitoring and detection of these resistance mutations that come up in lung cancer. For example, for EGFR mutation, the EGFR T790M mutation clone is something that can come up in about half of the patients after they've been on treatment with first and second generation oral targeted therapy. And our ability to detect that is important because we now have osimertinib, which is available specifically for those patients that have a T790M mutation detected after they have been on Tarceva, gefitinib, or afatinib. I will say that osimertinib is already approved for first-line setting as well. And in that case, if a patient has been on osimertinib, we still can use liquid biopsy to look at these other mutations that may emerge after the use of osimertinib. So the emergence of T790M is quite, I mean, it's almost non-existent. However, there are other mutations that can come up. And then, as Dr. Baumel said, when we are doing a tissue biopsy, we are really getting only a piece of the story. We are not getting a full picture of the entire tumor because we are really accessing just a piece. But assessing the blood may be able to give us a more complete picture because a tumor is shedding from, you know, its entirety, meaning, let's say, if their disease is only localized to the lung or to the pleural effusion, our ability to detect a mutation in their blood or in their liquid biopsy is less as compared to somebody who has, you know, let's say, the liver involved or adrenal glands involved or bone involved. There are some technical issues that we are still working with in liquid biopsy. We are very good at calling out EGFR, KRAS. However, we are not very good at calling out things like MET, HER2. I think those are still things that are limiting the applicability of a biopsy approach like this, for example, in breast cancer. And then I would just end by saying that by using this approach, we are really, truly entering an era of personalized therapy where we are able to really diagnose, monitor, and then change therapy based on the available information. And this has really improved the delivery of personalized care. So I'll stop there and take any questions. Thank you.